That's right. So today I will continue and I will talk about the connection between the Langlands program and gauge theory. But let me remind you what we discussed last time. First of all, I talked about this sort of André Weiss point of view, where you have three different colons, three different tracks, number theory, curves over finite fields, and Riemann surfaces. And so the origin of the Langlands program is in these two tracks, where you talk about Galois groups of number fields, such as the field of rational numbers, and also Galois groups of the function fields of curves like this. And so it's like sometimes people refer to this as a classical Langlands correspondence. And then these two tracks is something more recent, which involves geometry. So this is sort of classical, and this is geometric Langlands program. And so we discussed this, and at the end I described what appears to be the most satisfactory form of the geometric Langlands correspondence for Riemann surfaces, or perhaps I prefer the language of algebraic geometry, so we will view them really as curves over the field of complex numbers. So this is something which is also very close to what Dima Rinkin is describing in his lectures, which is, you know, and also related to his work with gauge theory, and going back to the work of Bellinson and Ginfield and Lamon and Rostin and others. So in the third colon, this categorical Langlands correspondence is viewed as an equivalence of two categories. So maybe I should say, as before, that we have a curve X over a complex number, smooth projective irreducible curve, as before. And then we have a reductive algebraic group, reductive algebraic group over C, and LG is the Langlands dual group. So then we have two moduli stacks, one for the group G, which is moduli stack of G bundles, which is called bund G, and we have another one, which is moduli stack of flat bundles, but for the dual group, which I call log LG. And Arinkin calls it LS, I think, for local systems. So slightly different notation, but same thing. And we have two categories associated to this moduli stacks. On this side, it's a category of D modules on this moduli stack. And on this side, it's a category of O modules. And so now, first of all, we should do something with these categories for them to be to have a chance to be equivalent to each other. We have to give them this chance, and for that we have to, first of all, look at derived categories, maybe bounded derived categories. But also, in addition, we have to make some modification. And I think Dima Rinkin will tell us more about this in his next talk, so I will not get into these details. But there is a certain way now to formulate this conjecture. And so you have to modify, say, one of these categories. And after that, the conjecture is that these two categories become equivalent. And that is a statement of categorical Langlands correspondence. I mentioned last time that in the abelian case, when G is GL1, or if you will, the multiplicative group, this is actually a theorem. This is known. And it is a version of the Fourier-Mukai transform, which was studied in particular by Lamon, Jar Lamon, and Mitch Rostin. And for general, it's a conjecture due to Arinkin and Gaisgary, and maybe even hopefully soon maybe will be proved in some cases, maybe already proved. So we'll hear more about this from Arinkin, I think, tomorrow. All right. Now, this equivalence is compatible, is supposed to be compatible with various operations, with various properties. And one of the crucial properties is a compatibility with a certain set of functors. On one side, these functors are the Hecke functors. I will call them H, V, X. And they were described by Arinkin. They are parameterized by representation of the dual group, by a finite dimensional algebraic representation of the dual group, and a point, a C point of X. So there is a family of functors called Hecke functors, which act on this category. And on this category as well, there is a family of functors. So let's call them F, Vx. I call them Frobenius. Sometimes they're called Wilson functors, but it's maybe more appropriate to call them Frobenius functors. And so these are much, you saw that the definition of the Hecke functors is rather non-trivial, because what you need to do is to modify your G bundle at a given point, X. And the modification, it depends on the choice of the representation of the dual group, but the definition of the modification is quite non-trivial, because for different modifications, you sort of multiply by different vector spaces, which are the stocks of a certain Provorshiv, a fine Grassmannian associated to this representation. But in contrast, these functors are very simple. And this is a typical situation that something which is simple on one side, under this kind of duality, this kind of Fourier transform, becomes complicated on the other side. It's not so unusual. For instance, we know that under Fourier transform, also simple things become complicated and vice versa. And that's the beauty of it, that we can use the Fourier transform to make complicated things into simple. So maybe I should mention this, because I think it's a very instructive thing about these functors, because then it becomes more clear why we end up in this construction with Hecke-Eigen sheaves for skyscraper sheaves here. So the point is that if you take X times L log LG, then you have a tautological bundle. You have a tautological bundle. So this is LG bundle. So universal, let's call it universal. LG bundle. Because it is the moduli space of flat bundles. So each point here is a pair, E nabla, where E is a principal LG bundle and nabla is a connection. So I already explained that I like the point, holomorphic point of view. It's a holomorphic bundle or algebraic. It is the same. And this is a holomorphic connection or algebraic, also the same, on X. Okay? So this is like on X. But so, because it is a moduli stack, really, of this, there is a universal LG bundle on this product, on this Cartesian product. And moreover, this bundle has a partial connection along X. So that for a given point E, if I restrict it, I will end up precisely with this connection nabla. Okay? And so now, I'm also given a point, and I'm given a representation of the dual group. So what do I do? First of all, I take the associated vector bundle. So I take V tau, which is just tau times LG V, the associated vector bundle, whose fibers are going to be isomorphic to V everywhere. But it's a vector bundle. And then I restrict V tau to X times log. I have a point X in here. So I can restrict to this point times log. So as a result, I obtain a vector bundle just on log. The tautological bundle was, universal tautological bundle was on a cross, on the Cartesian product. But I use this point X to restrict. And I get something just on log LG. Okay, so this is a vector bundle. But because it's a vector bundle, it gives an O module. Because an O module. So let's say that V tau is the O module associated module on log of sections of this guy. But I have to, yes, I have to, maybe I have to put a point x in here, because I choose a point x. And okay, so now the functor, the Frobenius functor, or sometimes called Wilson functor, because of Wilson as in quantum physics, simply takes a sheaf, so f vx, applied to a sheaf f, an O-module f, is just a tensor product of f with this vector bundle, or the sheaf of sections of this vector bundle. So it's very simple. You see, you don't do any modifications or anything. You just multiply by vector bundle, or the sheaf of sections of the vector bundle, more precisely, because we are talking about O-modules. So, for example, let's suppose that f is a skyscraper sheaf, as we discussed last time. So again, E is a point of log, and suppose it is a smooth point. Suppose it is smooth, so there is a unique reducible torsion sheaf supported at this point. That is the skyscraper sheaf. Skyscraper sheaf. It's an O-module. And let's see what will happen when we apply this functor to it. We have to multiply this sheaf by a vector bundle. But when you multiply a skyscraper sheaf by a vector bundle, you're effectively multiplying it by a vector space, namely the fiber of this vector bundle at this point, because everywhere else it's zero, so it doesn't matter. So you just multiply by the fiber. It's actually true for any O-module, in particular for this vector bundle. So this is going to be isomorphic, really, to just V, vector space V itself, as just a vector space. I underline just to make sure that we're talking about this vector space, times the original guy. And this is true for any x in x, in any v. So you see right away that this guy is an eigensheaf. Right? It's an eigensheaf of all of these functors, whose eigenvalues, so to speak, eigenvalue now in this categorical world are not numbers, but they're vector spaces, is the vector space underlying this representation. Now, you can also wonder what will happen when you kind of start moving x. Allow yourself to x move along the curve x. And this Arinkin addressed this in the case of Hecke functors. But it's the same story here. And when you do that, these vector spaces will combine into a flat vector bundle, which will inherit its connection from the universal bundle. I don't want to talk about this too much, but I just wanted to give this idea that this guy is clearly an eigensheaf for these functors. But if so, and if we do believe that there is such an equivalence, which is compatible with the set of functors f on this side and the set of functors h on this side, then clearly, under this equivalence, this should correspond to a sheaf here, which is D-module on bund G, which is an eigensheaf for these guys. That's why we say in geometric Langlands correspondence that for every local system, at least for irreducible ones, ones which correspond to smooth points, there has to exist a non-zero D-module on bund G, which is a Hecke eigensheaf, which is an eigensheaf for all of these functors. We recover immediately this statement of Hecke eigensheaf statement for this guy if we take this point of view that what really is going on is not that we attach to each E some sheaf, but in fact there is an equivalence of categories. So it's like attaching to a delta function. I explained yesterday, 2 days ago, in Fourier transform, we attach to a delta function, exponential function, the wave. Right? And so whatever properties the delta function has, then they will have to be inherited by the image under the transform. That's why this is a Hecke eigensheaf. This is a Hecke eigensheaf. Okay? So that's where we are. And now what I would like to do is to connect this equivalence to something which happens in a totally different area, supposedly, totally different area of science, namely in quantum physics, in four-dimensional super Young Mills. So in other words, what I would like to do is to add one more colon to this Andrei Wei's picture, that in addition to these three tracks, which go in parallel, according to Andrei Wei, there is actually one more track, as it turns out, at least in the context of the language program, which has to do with quantum physics, with things like four-dimensional super Young-Mills theory and two-dimensional sigma models. So I will explain now. So the beginning of this story, the origin of this story, which will now connect to this categorical language correspondence, is in the so-called electromagnetic duality. When you study multivariable calculus, or when you teach multivariable calculus, as probably is the case for most of you here, you talk about Maxwell's equations. This is a very good example of a system of linear partial differential equations. And they're written on two vector fields, E and B, the electric field and the magnetic field. Now, if you write these equations in the vacuum, and you ignore the speed of light, set it equal to 1, then you will see that the equations stay the same if you send E to B and B to negative E. This is the electromagnetic duality of the classical electromagnetism, that the electric and magnetic fields enter the equations governing classical electromagnetism in a kind of a symmetrical way, in a balanced harmonic, in a certain harmony. There's a certain harmony between them. You can exchange them and the equations stay the same. So then, of course, the question is whether such a duality can also be observed in the quantum theory of electromagnetism. Because, of course, we know that the world is quantum. So this is a natural question. And it turns out that quantum electrodynamics, the theory which governs quantum electromagnetism, does not exhibit this duality, electromagnetic duality. But its close cousin, a supersymmetric extension, a maximal supersymmetric extension, does. So the quantum level, we consider what's called the maximal, or technical term is n=4, supersymmetric electromagnetism, so to speak. Supersymmetric simply means that in addition to the Poincaré group, the Lorentz group, the Poincaré group, which is a group of symmetries of any relativistic quantum field theory, and therefore any realistic quantum field theory, because we know that the world has to obey relativism, it is extended, the symmetry is extended by to a certain supergroup in which the Poincaré group is the even part. And those extensions have been classified, and the biggest one is called n=4. So maximal supersymmetric theory of electromagnetism is a theory in which, in addition to the standard, the usual fields which we observe in electromagnetism, there are some additional fields, more the additional fermions and bosons, such that on the whole thing, on the space of fields, you have an action not only of a Poincaré group, but of the maximal super Poincaré group. Okay. And then this theory actually is superconformal. So it's conformal, so it means that the electric charge actually is a number, so to speak. You probably know that in the usual electromagnetism, which is not superconformal, it's not a conformal field theory, this electric charge is something which is not really well defined. It depends on which energy scale we are considering the theory. So there is a certain randomization group flow which is moving this electric charge. But for this supersymmetric theory, actually there is a number, there's electric charge. Sort of, I quote it in quotes because so it actually is a number which characterizes the theory. There is one parameter in the theory, kind of like electric charge. And then it turns out that this theory, well, at least at the level in which we can describe it today, it's not precise, completely rigorous, but at the level in which we can understand, this theory exhibits electromagnetic duality. In other words, there is a way to exchange electric and magnetic properties of the theory the same way as we exchange electromagnetic vector fields in Maxwell's equation, so that the theory stays the same. Plus, we have to make one additional change. Namely, we have to replace E by 1 over E. Electric charge replaces it by its inverse. So in particular, in such a theory, well, there should be an analog of an electron, so something which carries electric charge. But because it exhibits this duality, there has to be also a particle which carries magnetic charge, so kind of a monopole, magnetic monopole. And of course, in the real world, we don't observe monopoles. We only see dipoles, the usual magnets. And we can't isolate, as we all know, by breaking, because we just end up with two dipoles. But Dirac theorized in the 30s that maybe there exists such monopoles, magnetic monopoles. And in fact, it was a very useful idea because he was able to, just from that and some very simple study of homotopy groups, he was able to derive the fact that electric charge is quantized. So it was a very interesting idea. But of course, they have not yet been observed, maybe because they're too heavy that we don't see them. But anyway, if in this supersymmetric theory, for example, an electron would correspond under this duality to a magnetic monopole, and so on. But there is this very important aspect, which is that also the parameter E gets replaced by its inverse. And this is very important. It's very important because in today's study of quantum physics, most of the results that we obtain are what people call perturbative. Perturbative means that they're really obtained as power series in some parameter, or perhaps several parameters. So I want to, instead of explaining this in more detail, I want to illustrate this by a very simple example. Namely, consider the following power series. 1 over n factorial times x to the n. So each coefficient makes perfect sense. You consider a set of n objects, and you consider all permutations of them. So you denote the cardinality of the set of permutations by n factorial, you take its inverse, and you form a generating function of this number. So each number makes perfect sense combinatorially. For each n, there is a certain number, which is natural. But when you put them in a power series, it is what it is. It is just kind of a way to encode all these numbers together. But we don't know what this function is. That's perturbative. And it converges a priori. This kind of series will converge in a particular domain. Well, in this case, actually, it converges everywhere. But in some other cases, it would only converge in a particular domain. So that's a perturbative result. When you get something like this, a non-perturbative result would be this. See, there is a very big difference between these two. This talks about coefficients. This does not talk about coefficients. It talks about the values. So some value, which is imaginary, suddenly gives you a negative 1. Right? So that's one example. Maybe a better example, because we talked about modular forms last time. Maybe a better example would be to look at the generating series like this. So P of n, q to the n. So now here the formal variable was x. This is the variable. Now I will denote the variable by q, formal variable again. But now I will write this as a, so this will be generating function of all partitions. So all partitions of n. So this is also Euler has to do with this, and Euler has to do with this, Euler has to do with many of these things. So he was a very non-trivial guy who discovered a lot of those things, sometimes not being fully aware exactly what these things are. Okay, and so then the point is, let's call this phi of q. And so then Euler has this formula that it's a product of 1 minus q to the I inverse I from 1 to infinity, right? So that's very beautiful. But again, this is a power series. So it contains information about each of these coefficients. So if you know this power series, you know every coefficient. So you know the number of partitions of every n. So this is a perturbative result. A non-perturbative result would be to say the following, that if you take phi of q inverse and multiply it by something very benign, q to the 1 over 24 for some reason, which of course we also know why, because same earlier explained to us that 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 is not infinity, but if you look at it in a certain way, it's at minus 1 over 12. So that also is goes into this. So it's really black magic is happening. I think our problem sometimes is that we forget that it is magic. And we kind of say, think it's not. And we get used to it. So we have to reawaken ourselves to the fact that it is really amazing. And when we do that, I think we will see maybe more than we can see right now. Because now we take it for granted, but we should not. So this is a so-called the Dedekind eta function, which is more or less the same thing. Well, you take the inverse and multiply it by some q to one. So what? It's no big deal. It's more or less the same as this. But the magic is that if you write q to the e to the 2 pi I tau, then it turns out that this function has very special properties under the modular transformations. A tau goes to A tau plus B or C tau plus D. It's more or less invariant under this and after some corrections. Okay. So see, this has not, you cannot see that property, this modularity property from this. So this is perturbative, but this is non-perturbative. And likewise in quantum field theory. Today's quantum field theory is here, but we would like to be here. And this is an indication that it is possible because it tells you that actually the theory should exist for all values of E and not just for the small values of E, like electric charge is very small. And this is the basis of all the calculations which are done in quantum electrodynamics today. But this is an indication because this theory is equivalent to a theory with small e, is equivalent to a theory with very large e, namely the inverse of a small one. That tells you that actually theory exists everywhere. It is like this, or it is maybe, there is one very special transformation here. Tau goes to minus 1 over tau, where sort of something which is very close to origin goes to something very close to infinity. So it's very similar to this. Now this is almost the same as this. That's what this duality is about. That's why people are so interested in this. It's not because, you replace bielectric by magnetic, which is very interesting by itself. But it's more about the fact that actually it indicates that the theory exists non-perturbatively. We do not know yet. It's like you don't know yet what the Dedekind eta function is, but you already know that if it existed, it will have to have modular property. This is already a very strong result. So now, this is all beautiful, but we realize in modern language, that this electromagnetism or its supersymmetric extension is what's called gauge theory or Young-Mills theory with the simplest possible non-trivial gauge group, namely the abelian group U1, the circle group. So this is gauge theory or Young-Mills theory with gauge group U1. But there are gauge theories with other gauge groups, which are general compact Lie groups. So let's consider a general gauge theory with gauge group, which we will call G. But I don't want to call it G because in my previous discussion, G was a reductive algebraic group over C. And now in physics, we want a compact Lie group. But there is one-to-one correspondence because you can take the maximal compact subgroup. For example, for GLNC, you take a unitary group. For SLN, you get SUN, and so on. So I will call it GC, C for compact. So it's a maximal compact subgroup of this G, so that there is no confusion between notation. There's no clash in notation. And then we can ask whether, for such gauge theory, there is also an analog of electromagnetic duality. And if it is, how does it work? So this was a question which was asked in the mid-70s by physicists Goddard, Knights, and Olive, and then by Montanen and Olive. And they came up with a surprising answer. So first of all, in modern terms, they also considered n equal 4 supersymmetric extension of this gauge theory, which, by the way, these gauge theories, of course, are an example of such a gauge theory, the standard model, which describes three forces of nature, as we know, pretty accurately in a particular range of energies, anyway. So this is just as interesting as studying electromagnetism from the point of view of understanding the world. But we do it for general compactly groups, and we take the maximal supersymmetric extension, for which the theory becomes sort of simpler in many ways. So in particular, it also is superconformal, and there is a parameter, just like here, there was parameter E, and here there will be a parameter G. But in fact, the better description is, so this theory has some fields. So for example, I don't want to spend too much time on this, because you can read it everywhere. Oh, and maybe I should mention, the one place where you can read what I'm talking about today is my Bourbaki talk, which I gave a few years ago, which is on the archive. So everything I skipped today, you can find, more or less, or some of the formulas that I skipped today, you can find. It is on the archive 0906-2747. Except the part about magic. I didn't talk about this. That's a special for today. So there are more details. So I'm going to skip. The point is that actually you consider a certain. Actually, there are two parameters. There is also so-called theta angle, which has to do with just separating the contributions from bundles of different Poincaré Pontryagin class. So we're studying gauge theory, we study connections on G bundles, on GC bundles, on the four-dimensional manifold. So I have to say it's four-dimensional theory, 4D. So there is a parameter tau, which involves this sort of electric charge, so to speak, analog of the electric charge, and this theta angle. And it is like this. It's not really that important, but I will write it like this. And so what they found when they studied, so there's a theory for every value of tau, and every compactly group, there is a theory. This n equal 4, four-dimensional super-Young-Mills. Okay, it's well-defined. It has just one complex parameter. And it turns out that this theory is equivalent to a theory with minus 1 over tau, with a parameter minus 1 over tau, which, by the way, if theta is 0, if theta is 0, then minus 1 over tau. So tau is more or less 1 over g squared, and minus 1 over tau is more or less g squared. So replacing tau by minus 1 over tau is like replacing g by g squared, up to some small correction, like 4 pi, and so on. Okay. So it is very similar to what we had before, e goes to 1 over e. But there is a twist here, which is that the gauge group here will be different. It will not be the original gauge group, GC, but it will be the dual group, the Langlands dual. Langlands duality up to now was described only for, say, groups over algebraically closed field or maybe a slightly more general situation. So here we apply it to this compactly group, so it's a group over the field of real numbers. But it works the same way because it's a maximal compact, so this will be the maximal compact of the dual of the complexly group. Okay, so this was a big surprise in the 70s. So they did not know, the physicists who discovered this, whom I mentioned earlier, they did not know about the work of Langlands. They did not know that this group had already been described a few years before, 8 or 10 years ago, 10 years before. They ran into it by, were forced into it by when they did the calculations and tried to see how this duality would work. And this is really remarkable, that suddenly the same thing, the same dual group, which is the mark and really a crucial ingredient of the Langlands correspondence, shows up in this totally different context. So already in the 1980s, people became aware that it is a dual group, and the question was asked, why? And for many years, there was no answer. For 20 years, there was no answer, 25 years. And finally, about 10 years ago, the ideas appeared, starting with the work of Kapustin and Witten, which I'm going to now describe. But I want to say something here, which I think is important. There are two ways to look at this. One way is to say that there are two different theories. One of them is the gauge theory with this gauge group and this parameter. And the other one is the gauge theory with this gauge group and this parameter. And these two theories are equivalent. But I think it's not a good way to look at it. Because, first of all, in today's quantum field theory, we only describe things for small values of the parameter, perturbatively. So if this one makes sense, so tau is small, so to speak, let's suppose theta is 0, so it will be just that g is small, then in this theory it will be large. So actually it's out of reach. So it sort of doesn't really make sense to talk about, because we don't have an independent definition of this theory. So I think what's much better, and actually some recent work confirms that this picture is better, is to say that in fact there is only one theory. There is only one theory for every tau, but there are two different ways to look at it. When you look in one way, you see this. When you look another way, you see that. But the theory is the same. It doesn't know how we look at it. It's there. It exists. Well, we try to describe it. But we have to be aware that there is a difference between sort of the reality and the way we describe reality. Or someone put, you know, there's a difference between the menu and the meal, right? So this is a menu. We say, in this theory, you have this particle, this particle, this particle, this Lagrangian, and so on. It's a menu. But you study the menu, it doesn't mean that you already ate it, right? So, and this is another menu. So the same meal, the same dish is described by two different menus. That's what's happening here. Or more mathematically, I don't know, I like to think about it like this. Think you take a cylinder, you can project it down, you will see a rectangle, and every point in the cylinder for you will appear as a point in the rectangle and a point in the interval above it. That's one way. But somebody else will project onto a vertical plane and will see a disk, and every point in the cylinder, I mean the kind of a solid cylinder, we'll see a point on the disk and a point in the interval above it. And then they will meet and they say, what did you study today? I studied a rectangle with some points above it. And what did you do? I studied a disk with some points above it. And they will have no idea that they're studying the same thing. Right? But they are. And this is what's happening here. But actually more is true, which is that the theory exists sort of for all values of tau. But this one is for small values. This one is really well defined for small values of tau. And this is for very large values of tau, for which 1 is minus 1 over tau is well defined. So this guy can only study this. This guy can only study this. But the theory actually exists everywhere for all values. And in this regime, it can have this description. And in this regime, it can have that description. That is what's going on here. OK. Now, how does this connect? How can we connect this to this equivalence of categories that we talked about? So this is where we come to. This is where we come to the work of Kapustin and Winter. It was published in 2006. So, well, first of all, here we. Gauge theory is defined on a four-manifold, M4. And it really has to do with the study of, as I said, bundles for this, principal bundles for this gauge group, GC, connections on them, and various sections of various bundles associated with this bundle, with this principal bundle. Sections of vector bundles associated with this principal G bundle. So it's four-dimensional. Whereas in Langlands program, in the geometric Langlands program, we have an algebraic curve over C, which is a Riemann surface. So it's two-dimensional, has two real dimensions. So we have to somehow go from a four-dimensional space to a two-dimensional space. We have to solve that issue first. And they do it in an elegant way. They say, let's suppose that our four-dimensional manifold is a product, is a Cartesian product of two Riemann surfaces. One is our friend X, which has to do, which will, you know, on which the Langlands program is unfolding. And then will be a second one, which we'll call sigma. And then they say that we do what physicists call dimensional reduction. It means that we are considering the theory in the limit when this is very small. The size of this is much smaller than the size of this. So effectively, you end up with a theory on sigma. It's going to be a two-dimensional theory. But the theory will remember about x. Technically, what it means is that when you write all the equations in this limit, you have to eliminate all the derivatives with respect to coordinates along x. So you only get equations on sigma. So you really get something just on sigma. They call it an effective two-dimensional theory in this limit. So they start with this theory. And the first thing they do is they show that the effective two-dimensional theory on sigma, they describe what it is. In fact, this was essentially done even before them in the mid-90s by two groups of physicists. So this was already known, but those physicists did not make the next step, which Kapustin-Witten made. So what is that theory? That theory is the so-called sigma model, supersymmetric sigma model. Supersymmetric sigma model. Sigma model with target manifold. Manifold, the so-called Hitchin moduli space associated to G. And I will explain in a second. Now, what does it mean to say sigma model? Well, in gauge theory, we are studying connections on GC bundles on this four-dimensional manifold M4. And in this two-dimensional theory, we are studying maps from sigma to what is called a target manifold. In this case, it's going to be this manifold, which is denoted like this, and called the Hitchin moduli space. Hitchin moduli space. And you see, it remembers. So actually, it remembers about G, and it also remembers about X. Maybe I should say this. So there is a quantum field theory, two-dimensional quantum field theory, actually superconformal, which is in which a path integral, say, if you think in terms of path integral, is described as an integral over all maps from sigma to this manifold. The same way as in gauge theory, path integral is a path integral over maps from, over connections on M4 plus some additional fields. Likewise, here there will be some additional fields, which will be sections of certain vector bundles on sigma obtained by pullback from things like tangent and cotangent bundles in here. It doesn't matter at this point. Okay. Now, there is one more ingredient in this story. And this is so-called topological twist. In principle, all of this works out nicely. You have gauge theory, supersymmetric gauge theory. Then you have this two-dimensional sigma model, which is its effective theory in limit when one of the two-dimensional surfaces becomes very small. The problem is that these theories are very complicated. Very complicated. And so what physicists do is they simplify. So they look at a very, very small sector of this theory, which is already interesting, so which gives you non-trivial results. It's called the topological sector or BPS sector. And the idea is that you, in your, remember I talked about the Poincaré group, which is a group of symmetries. And now Poincaré group becomes the sort of the even part of a supergroup. But maybe we should talk about Lie algebra, so let's call let this be the Lie algebra. Then you have this plus P1. So there will be odd part. And this will be your super Poincaré Lie algebra. And the idea is to find some element Q in here whose square is 0. And then only focus on things which are invariant under Q. And this was realized by Witten in the late 80s, that if you do that, you actually obtain a very sort of a small kind of finite dimensional sector of the theory where all path integrals will localize in finite dimensional spaces. So you get finite dimensional integrals. This was a way in which Witten in 1988 interpreted Donaldson theory. The Donaldson invariants were interpreted as correlation functions in this topological sector. So, but the problem is that if you just do it in the theory, this Q does not exist. Or more precisely, it may exist, but it is not invariant under the even part. And that means that if you are on a flat space, so if you are on R4, you can make sense of Q, but you cannot do it for a general manifold, four-dimensional manifold, with non-trivial metric. But we want non-trivial manifold, X times sigma. So you have to find Q, which is also invariant under the even part. But what if you don't have any? So what to do? And so the idea is that you can modify the action of the even part. And this is what's called topological twisting. So you can modify the action because you have some additional residual symmetry in your theory. It's not so important at this point, but basically it turns out that this theory itself could be thought of as a dimensional reduction of a 10-dimensional n equal 1 super Young Mills. So you have a 10-dimensional manifold, which is M4 times M6, and M6 becomes very small. But when you look at it this way, you see immediately that there is an additional symmetry of SO6 from this additional, or maybe spin 6. And so you can try to use it. So you modify the action of the Poincaré group on all your fields by using this additional symmetry, and that's what's called the twisted theory. So we have to realize that this is not a physical theory anymore. So for example, your spin statistics property is violated in this theory quite often, and so it's not a physical theory. It's not the original gauge theory we started with, but we get something in which Q exists. And there may actually be many ways to do it, so it may not be just one Q, but it could be a whole family of Qs, for example, and which is the case here, that actually Kapustin-Witten showed that there are two linearly independent, under a particular twisting, so under a particular modification, there are two different elements. And you can take their linear combination, you get one parameter family of this Q supercharges, whatever you want to call them. And then you restrict yourself only on things which commute with this Q. So that way you obtain what's called topological field theory. This is a very drastic reduction, for example, of the space of fields in this theory. If you do it, this is perhaps more familiar in the two-dimensional theory. And anyway, we are now already in two-dimensional theory because we have already done the reduction. So it already is happening in four dimensions, but let's look at the results here. So in 2D, there are essentially two types of topological theories. One is called the A model, and the other one is called the B model. Okay? And so what you're going to have is A model with the target manifold MH of G. And you're going to have the B model. And this A and B refers to two types of twisting that you can do, also in two dimensions. So the same story, but now you run the same story in two dimensions, and it turns out that there are essentially two ways to twist, change the action of the Poincaré group on the space of fields, so that you will end up with a supercharge. So there are two ways, and they're called A model, B model. It's just names. I mean, it doesn't mean anything. But for example, A model is something we know quite well because this has to do with quantum cohomology, for example. So the way quantum cohomology arises is precisely because we restrict ourselves to the fields which are annihilated by Q. The space of all fields in this theory is more or less differential forms on the loop space of your manifold. Actually, much more than that, but that's part of it. But when you write this operator Q, and you take the invariant things, if you restrict, to say, if you want to consider correlation functions of just things which are invariant, it turns out that if one of them is in the image, you get zero. So you effectively mod out this by the image of this operator. So you end up with a cohomology. And it turns out that cohomology is very small. So the cohomology of the whole differential forms on the whole loop space, so to speak, turns out to be just the cohomology of the manifold itself, which is finite dimensional. Loop space is infinite dimensional. A huge number of things. After you do this, it shrinks to just finite dimensional space of cohomology of the original manifold. And then you take those observables, you take the correlation functions, and what do you get? You get Gromov-Witten invariants. So this is how you get this stuff in topological theory. So that's the A model. So now we are going to do the A model with this target manifold. It depends on, the A model depends on the choice of a symplectic form. So now we need to discuss what this guy is, really. So this Hitchian moduli space is the moduli space of what's called Higgs pairs. A Higgs pair is a pair E and omega, where E is a principal G bundle on X. So now remember, X, G without C is a complex Lie group, and we consider a holomorphic or algebraic, if you will, G bundle on X. And omega is a one form. So let me introduce a notation. G is a Lie algebra of G, and GE is by definition E times G it's a vector bundle associated to E and the adjoint representation. And omega is a section of this bundle, tensored with the canonical line bundle, the bundle of holomorphic one forms, line bundle of holomorphic one forms on X. Okay? So this is what a Higgs pair is. This is one description of this moduli space. In fact, it turns out that this manifold is hyperkeller. Hyperkeller manifold, which was studied first by Hitchin, by Nigel Hitchin. That's why it's often called Hitchin moduli space. It's hyperkeller. And as usual, hyperkeller means that you have not just one complex structure, but you have a whole P1 of complex structures. And usually people denote IJK. There's three basic structures. And there are three different incarnations, if you will, of this moduli space. And this is one of the incarnations. In complex structure I, it is a moduli space of Higgs pairs like this. And then you realize that this also has it's a Keller manifold with this complex structure. And so it is in particular symplectic manifold, has a symplectic structure. And this is a symplectic structure which we use in defining the same model. On the other hand, we have a B model for the dual one. So dual one is described in the same way, but you have principal bundles for the group LG and Higgs fields also. And B model depends on a complex structure instead of symplectic form. And the complex structure here is going to be the other one, which is called J. And it turns out that in the complex structure J, it appears not as a moduli space of stable or semi-stable G pairs of bundle and a Higgs field, but instead the moduli of semi-stable flat bundles. So MH of LG with respect to the complex structure J is in fact E nabla, where this is a LG bundle, holomorphic, and this is a connection on it. Connections, of course, form a torsor, a principal homogeneous space or affine space over the vector space of one forms. So nabla lives in an affine space, which is modeled on the vector space where omega lives. So not that far away, but they're different as complex manifolds, and certainly as Keller manifolds and algebraic manifolds. So that's the other moduli space. And you see, it is very similar to log LG. Because log LG is more or less the same thing. You also consider E nabla exactly the same. But the difference is that here in this theory, what you get is the moduli of stable flat bundles. And here you get the moduli stack of all flat bundles. So roughly speaking, this is kind of an open locus in here. But it's not quite true, because you also identify some semi-stable flat bundles with each other, which you don't do here. But this is very, very close, you see. So this is one of the reasons why this is going to end up connected to this. And I'm out of time, so 5 more minutes. So let me get to that connection. So there's one more step. So far we have two. So we started with two Young-Mills, super Young-Mills theories, which under this duality, which by the way is called electromagnetic or S-duality, are equivalent to each other. Then we take their dimensional reductions. We get two-dimensional theories, which are also equivalent to each other. But then, okay, so what can we do with this? So in the 90s, people were very happy about this because they could use it to describe, say, quantum cohomologies and Gromov-Pitt invariants for one. This manifold, this is now called mirror symmetry. And people use that to describe the cohomologies of this in terms of some periods of some differential forms, which came from this side. So there was a big discovery, and there was many important developments in this area. But Kapustin-Witten realized that that's not the only thing you can do. Because if you have two theories are equivalent, or, as I would like to say, there is one theory which has two different descriptions, really. So you can look at objects other than correlation functions. You can also look at what physicists call brains. And brains are objects of a category, instead of, you know, being numbers or functions. And there are two types of brains. In this model, there are A brains. They're called A brains. And in this model, they're called B brains. So again, there is only one object, but from one point of view, it looks like A brain. From another point of view, it looks like B brain. So this mirror symmetry is the fact that you can have two different descriptions of this theory in that object. In one description, it will appear as a particular A brain. In another description, it will appear as a particular B brain. So what are the... And they form categories. So these are actually two categories that are attached to these two theories. And this category is almost the same as this category up here. And now we come to the punchline. So let me copy this equivalence of categories, which, by the way, this is called homological mirror symmetry. These are also derived categories and so on, which not really fully understood, but one expects this. And in fact, it was Kantsevich who anticipated this before everyone else in the mid-90s, before physicists even had the definition of brains. And he called it homological mirror symmetry. Let's copy it here. So here we have B brains on MH of LG. And here we have A brains on MH of G. And these two categories are equivalent. And this is homological mirror symmetry, whereas this is categorical Langlands correspondence. So what Kapustin and Witten did is that they kind of put them together, and they said, is there a link between the two? And they said, yes, there has to be a link, because this is more or less the same as this. Why? Because I did not explain what B brains are, but B brains are essentially just coherent sheaves, so they are like O modules. And this space, as I explained, is a kind of a stable or semi-stable part of this moduli stack. So there is slight discrepancy, which is not really fully understood today. It's not fully understood in the following sense, that when we said that the effective two-dimensional theory on sigma is really just a sigma model with this target space, this is not really true. It is true near sort of in a smooth locus of this. But when there are singularities, then things become more complicated. And it is expected that those singularities somehow mathematically are reflected in the structure of this algebraic stack. So they should not really be exactly the same, because there is some questions here. And there are some questions here. And so there should be something in between, which is sort of the right object. But at least you can see that they're very, very close on this side. On the other hand, so that's very good. But on the other hand, these are actually very different, because these are D modules on Banji, and these are A brains on MH. And MH is moduli of pairs, of Higgs pairs. So at first, it looks like completely different. Until we realize that actually this guy, MH, is almost like the cotangent bundle to Banji, because this is actually the cotangent bundle to Banji at E. E is a G bundle, so it, suppose it is irreducible, so it's a smooth point of Banji. Then this is a cotangent space. You can do it by standard Kadare-Spencer argument and serial duality, that this, because this is H0, which is dual to H1, X with coefficients G, E. More precisely dual, but dual is isomorphic to G itself, so there is some duality in here, but... And this is a tangent space, so when you take the dual, you get this. So this, a cotangent space, and so you put them all together, you get a cotangent bundle. So this, again, up to the fact that one is moduli space of semi-stable things and the other one is moduli stack, this is more or less the cotangent bundle to Banji. And so then they said, wow, very interesting. So Langlands correspondence tells us that this category should be the category of D modules on band G. But physics mirror symmetry, homological mirror symmetry, tells us that it should be the category of A brains on more or less the cotangent bundle to band G. And then they said, well, perhaps these two should be equivalent to each other for some other reasons which have nothing to do with this or this. And this, in fact, that they proposed this and this connection. And actually, since then, there has been a lot of progress in mathematics, in particular in the work of David Nadler and Eric Zaslow and others, and actually some earlier work of Pierre Shapira and Kashiwara and others who worked in microlocal analysis, that actually there is such a link. And this became a very fruitful and very fascinating area of mathematics. But from this point of view, what we see is really a triangle of equivalences, because this is more or less, this is kind of the same. There is a geometric Langlands, categorical Langlands. There is homological mirror symmetry, which comes from S-duality, right? And there is also this sort of microlocalization, which connects D-modules on band G and A-brains on the Hitchian moduli space. And the idea of Kapustin-Witten was that this sort of a commutative triangle of categories, equivalent categories. And it is in this sense that S-duality is connected to the geometric Langlands. Now, I have to stop, but I just want to say that since then, there has been a lot of progress in both mathematics and physics. And one of the areas in which progress has been made is that people realize that actually there are much more general theories, much more general equivalences like this in physics. And this particular work of Gaiotto and his collaborators, an AGT conjecture, Aldai, Gaiotto, and Tachikawa. And so this gives it sort of a new angle on what this equivalence is. And one can hope that perhaps the same kind of picture can be found also in mathematics. So I think it's very interesting. But also even before that, this has already produced some interesting insights into the geometric Langlands correspondence, because we can now we have a new description of this correspondence, of this equivalence, and we can learn something from this and then try to transport it back here and then maybe travel back through the other colons eventually of the Langlands, of the André Weiss big picture, and go back to the initial questions which have puzzled mathematicians for so many years. And so I hope some of you will be able to do that. Thank you very much. Okay, so let me repeat the question because so that whoever is viewing it online can hear. The question is, which parts of this are conjectures, which parts are theorems, and so on, right? So this is a conjecture which used to be understood as a meta-conjecture, so to speak. So it was understood as a kind of a general philosophical guiding principle. But luckily now, only maybe three years ago, Arinkin and Gaisbury finally pinned it down, so now there is a precise conjecture here. And I think he will explain this in more detail perhaps tomorrow, I hope. And as far as I know, Gaisbury, they have made progress in proving it, at least for GL2. Well, for GL1 it's a theorem, as I explained, by Rostin and Lamont. For GL2 it seems, I don't know exact status today, but it seems very close to being proved, maybe for GLN as well. So this is kind of, we are kind of in good shape here, it seems. Here, it's more murky. There are many questions in regards to what the status of this is. Homological mirror symmetry has been proved in many cases. For example, it's been proved by Fotorai, which is kind of like abelian case, which is like the abelian case here. So this is, it's known for Torre, but it's known for a much larger now class of manifolds, but still not for all manifolds. And these are very complicated because they're non-compact. So there are a lot of technical issues involved in really setting it up correctly. And there's also discrepancy. There is discrepancy between this category and this category. For example, from the physics point of view, they consider this as just a moduli of, naturally what comes out naturally is a moduli of representations of the fundamental group, which does not depend on the complex structure on the curve X, but only because the fundamental group does not depend on the complex structure. It has generators in relation, So there is a question, in what sense these are coherent sheaves? So most likely they are not coherent sheaves with respect to the algebraic structure on this, but analytic coherent sheaves. Whereas here we are taught to consider, we like to look in the language of algebraic geometry, so we are looking at algebraic coherent sheaves. So there's already a clash. So the two languages do not quite coincide. So there have to be some kind of reconciliation between them. So right now we don't, even though I say it's very similar, but they're not, because the two different spaces, the B brains are probably analytic sheaves as opposed to algebraic and so on. So this is, there are big questions. And also there are questions about what happens at the singular points, because what's going to happen at singular points. So Witten and I actually studied the simplest example of singularities, the orbifold singularities, when you have just a finite group of symmetries. And we saw some very interesting phenomena happening, which actually have to do, are closely connected to the phenomenon of endoscopy, which Hales is talking about, which has to do with fundamental lemma and so on. But the question when there is a singularity, for example, if you take the trivial bundle, the group of symmetries is the whole group. And so there are big questions about that. So I address some of these issues in my Bourbaki talk. So, for example, I mentioned work by Gaiota and Witten in which they consider more general boundary conditions in four-dimensional superangles, which kind of shed light on this a little bit. But as far as in my opinion, there are many questions which are unanswered in describing what this category is, and then of course also trying to set up an equivalence. Likewise, here even the definition of A-brains is in general problematic, because the typical A-brains are Lagrangian submanifolds with a unitary flat connection, with unitary flat bundle. These are objects of what's called a Foucault category. So morally, this should be a Foucault category, so the question is, to what extent this can be defined completely? But actually, there's more, because we realize that in addition to those, we should also allow some coisotropic submanifolds with some additional structure. In particular, in Kapustin-Witten's work, what allows us to migrate sort of from one to the other is a very special brain, which is called canonical coisotropic brain, which is supported on the entire moduli space. We call it ACC, the CC brain, canonical coisotropic brain. So it is like the Foucault category, plus some additional objects thrown in, which have to do with coisotropic manifolds, which are not Lagrangian. So it's quite complicated. Now, this connection, also very interesting, and as I said, there are some results by Nadler and Zaslow and others, which in some situations actually establish an equivalence, but then again, maybe not exactly the same categories, so they consider instead of D-modules constructible sheaves and things like that, so there's also not quite, but surely does not apply, as far as I know, to this guy, because first of all, non-compact, and it doesn't satisfy a certain condition which is used, at least in the earlier works of Nadler. I don't know how far this has progressed. So there are questions. Usually physicists know much more than we do, right? So I mean, it's kind of the typical. And then we try to prove some conjectures which they have. But here it's sort of opposite. We're kind of in good shape. This arrow seems to be in a better shape than other arrows. So we are, but only recently, due to Arinkin, Gaitskari, and others, now at least we have this as a precise conjecture. And everything else, there are many, many question marks. So, yes?
So what kind of structures do we gain or lose when we go from setting on complex numbers to setting on finite numbers or go to finite numbers?
Okay, so the question is what do we gain or lose when we interpolate between the third colon, so to speak, of the André Weil picture, complex over complex numbers, and the middle colon, which is over finite field. Well, so the nice thing about the middle colon is that it kind of combines everything, because so here you can have both functions, automorphic functions, for example, functions, and you can also have automorphic sheaves. Because it's already geometric, you're already in geometry, but you can still, it's still meaningful to kind of to just take the set of points and consider functions on the set of points. So in when we are curves over C, the current, the prevailing wisdom is that there are no functions, but there are only sheaves. But now, actually, I start thinking that maybe this is not right. So actually, Langlands has been adamant for years in my personal correspondence with him, and recently in some talks he has given. He's adamant that this has to exist also. There have to be some, has to be some honest harmonic analysis on band G. And sheaves are just very natural. Natural replacement. We kind of learn from Grothendieck that here functions can be transformed into sheaves, or, well, we can upgrade functions to sheaves, and then we say, oh, okay, but for sheaves we have analogs, so then it's that, maybe that's how it should be. But I think he's right. I think he's right that there should be a theory also of functions. And the analogy I want to use is the following. You see, the Langlands correspondence from one point of view is kind of like a conformal field theory. In fact, the work of Bellinson and Drinfeld relates the Langlands correspondence to a kind of conformal field theory for affine Kac-Moody algebras at the critical level. So this is something which I describe in my lectures, which are online, which I mentioned last time. But in conformal field theory, you see, there are these two different types of objects. There are conformal blocks, which are vector spaces, which are kind of chiral correlation functions of just chiral operators. But they're not really functions, they're sections of some bundles, which have a flat connection. So it is, there's really sections of D modules. So conformal blocks, so these are like conformal blocks. These are like conformal blocks, the sheaves. Sheaves of conformal blocks. In fact, the Heckhagen sheaves can be constructed as sheaves of conformal blocks. But in conformal field theory, we know that these are not physical correlation functions. You obtain physical correlation functions when you couple chiral blocks and anti-chiral blocks. And you find an invariant thing, right? So it is like, if you will, it's like harmonic function versus holomorphic function. So you can, well, for logarithms. It's like harmonic function versus, so you multiply holomorphic by anti-holomorphic. You take the module, the square of the modulus. Then you get a function, which can, the sections of the sheaves, they're going to have monodromes, complicated monodromes, and so on. So not really single-valued functions. But if you couple, there is a Hermitian inner product. And so if you couple things using this Hermitian inner product, you have to end up with something which is single-valued. And these are the honest correlation functions. So these are honest correlation functions, physical correlation functions. You can look at this very simple example. It's just lattice. You consider lattice vertex algebras, and you can see what's going on. So this is a very good example. So I think what Langlands is, the way I interpret what Langlands is saying is that there has to be an analog of this in Langlands also. So you have to also be able to do something by taking sort of these holomorphic things and take the kind of square of absolute value. So you get some, but not going to holomorphic things. They're going to be real. They're going to be smooth functions maybe, or some functions, some singularities. But there must exist some functions. That's what conformal field theory teaches us. So to go back to your question, the prevalent wisdom today is that the difference between curves over finite fields and curves over complex field is that here there are two stories which go in parallel, functions and sheaves. And here there are only sheaves. And this is what I used to believe. But now I think that maybe there is also this. And so in some sense, maybe there is a full analogy between the two.
Thank Edward again for his talk.